Tantor Audio presents The Men Who Lost America, British Leadership, the American Revolution, and the Fate of the Empire, by Andrew Jackson O'Shaughnessy. Narrated by Gildart Jackson. Your failure is, I am persuaded, as certain as fate. America is above your reach. Her independence neither rests upon your consent, nor can it be prevented by your arms. In short, you spend your substance in vain and impoverish yourself without hope. Thomas Paine, To the People of England, 1774. Introduction. At about 10 o'clock in the morning of October the 17th, 1781, outside the small tobacco port of Yorktown in Virginia, a lone drummer mounted the parapet of the besieged British lines, beating the call for a parley. The sound of his drum was inaudible against the background of constant firing. If it had not been for the visibility of his redcoat, he might have beat away until doomsday. He was followed by an officer holding up a white handkerchief and carrying a message proposing negotiations for surrender. The roar of American and French cannon suddenly ceased. Ebenezer Denny, a junior officer in the Pennsylvania line of the Continental Army, described how, when the firing ceased, I had never heard a drum equal to it, the most delightful music to us all. The troops on either side stared in silence at one another from a distance of less than 200 yards. While the drummer was sent back, the British officer was blindfolded and taken to the headquarters of General George Washington, where he delivered a message from General Charles, Earl Cornwallis, proposing a cessation of hostilities for 24 hours to allow two officers to meet at Mr. Moore's house to settle terms for the surrender of the posts of York and Gloucester. The request was refused, pending the submission of more detailed terms of surrender in writing. The opposing artillery resumed firing throughout the afternoon, but the battle was really over. The guns once again fell silent throughout the night, and the negotiations continued throughout the next day. At noon on October the 19th, the British Army lowered the Union Jack. The victors were forced to wait for the pleasure of seeing their humiliated foe parade before them. Although Washington had specified that the surrender ceremony would take place at 2 o'clock precisely, the British and German troops did not appear for another hour. Dressed in smart new uniforms, they formed two columns more than a mile long. Their path was bordered on one side by American troops and on the other by French. There were numerous spectators from the surrounding countryside, beaming with satisfaction and joy. The onlookers eagerly awaited the appearance of Cornwallis. He was the object of peculiar interest. A surgeon in the Continental Army, James Thatcher, described how every eye was ready to gaze on the humiliated commander. But Cornwallis disappointed their eager expectations by pleading illness or pretending indisposition. He instead sent his second in command, a ruddy-faced Irishman and plausible talker, Brigadier General Charles O'Hara of the Brigade of Guards, who had been bayoneted at the Battle of Guildford Court House and who had long believed that Britain was engaged in an unwinnable war in America. After some 2 hours of hushed anticipation, the vanquished British army began to advance along the Hampton Road, marching at a slow and solemn step, with shouldered arms, colours cased, drums beating, and fifes playing patriotic marches of Britain and the German states. As the captive army approached the opposing trenches, the elegantly mounted General O'Hara asked to be directed to the French commander, General Jean-Baptiste Donatien de Vimeur, Comte de Rochambeau. O'Hara removed his hat and apologized for the absence of his commanding officer. According to French accounts, he then attempted to surrender Cornwallis's sword to Rochambeau, who refused and deferred to General George Washington. An American officer added that O'Hara was mistaken. The commander-in-chief of our army is to the right. It was not an error. The British preferred to surrender to the French rather than acknowledge the ignominy of defeat by the Americans. O'Hara reluctantly tried to present the sword to Washington, but was referred by Washington to General Benjamin Lincoln, who had earlier been snubbed by the British when they refused him the usual courtesies of surrender at Charleston in South Carolina in 1780. Lincoln merely returned the sword to O'Hara and gave him directions to take his troops to a spacious field to lay down their arms. As they neared the field of surrender, the royal troops became disorderly and exhibited unsoldierly conduct, their step irregular, and their ranks frequently broken. Some of them seemed to be in liquor. When they entered the surrender field, with their spirit and pride put to the severest test, the last act of the drama was played out. They were unable to conceal their mortification. Their platoon officers appeared to be exceedingly chagrined when giving the order to ground arms. According to a New Jersey officer, the British officers in general behaved like boys who had been whipped at school, with some biting their lips and pouting, while others cried. They beat their drums as if they did not care how. Many of the soldiers showed a sullen temper, violently throwing down their arms into a single pile, as if determined to render them useless. After an intense siege following a march of 1,500 miles through the South, a corporal of the 76th Foot threw down his weapon with such violence that it broke, as he shouted, "May you never get so good a master!" The round, broad-brimmed hats of the soldiers enabled them to hide their faces out of shame. It was indeed a humiliation for an army that had begun the war with an assumption of its own superior military prowess. When he beheld the soldiers so reduced from their former glory to such a miserable plight, Edinus Burke of South Carolina reflected that he forgot for a moment their insolence, their depredations and cruelty. Throughout much of November 1781, there was still no certain news in London of the outcome of the Battle of Yorktown. As accounts of the strength of the enemy positions arrived, the mood of the government grew more anxious each day. George III and Lord George Germain, the cabinet minister most responsible for the conduct of the war, had been so confident of victory that the draft of the King's speech for the state opening of Parliament predicted British success in America. Germain, in particular, was aware that the outcome of the battle would determine the fate of the war and probably the future of the government of Lord North. He began to confide uneasiness on the subject to his friends. At noon on Sunday, November the 25th, 1781, Germain was at his London residence next to Carlton House in Pall Mall when he received official confirmation of the news that he had been dreading. Saying nothing to a guest, he immediately ordered his coach to drive to the residence of one of the other Secretaries of State, Lord Stormont, in Portland Place. After Germain imparted the disastrous information of the surrender of Lord Cornwallis, he and Stormont instantly drove to see the Lord Chancellor, Lord Thurlow, in Great Ormond Street. Following a short conference, they collectively decided to summon their nerve and go in person to the Prime Minister, Lord North. Between 1 and 2 o'clock in the afternoon, the three cabinet ministers arrived at the official residence of the Prime Minister in Downing Street. Although he had long despaired of the war and had many times attempted to resign, Lord North reacted to the news with shock. Germain described how the Prime Minister responded, as he would have taken a ball in his breast. Pacing up and down his rooms for several minutes, North suddenly opened his arms, exclaiming wildly, "Oh God, it is all over!" North repeated the words many times in a state of consternation and distress. After North had calmed down, The ministers discussed whether to postpone the state opening of Parliament, which was due to occur in less than 48 hours. With many members having already arrived in the capital and others on their way, they decided against a change. They then spent several hours rewriting the King's speech, which was to be delivered from the throne in the House of Lords. The speech had originally predicted victory, but was altered to make a token reference to the events at Yorktown. Germain then sent word of the melancholy termination of Lord Cornwallis's expedition to King George III, who was at Kew Palace on the outskirts of London. Germain then returned to his office in Whitehall, where he found additional confirmation of Cornwallis's defeat at Yorktown in a French account. As a supporter of the government and a member of Parliament, the memoirist Nathaniel Wraxall attended a dinner party with nine other guests that evening at Lord George Germain's home in Pall Mall. Apart from Thomas de Grey, Lord Walsingham, who had formerly served as an undersecretary to Germain, the guests were unaware of the fateful news that Germain had received from America. Before the dinner was finished, one of the servants delivered an urgent message from the king. Looking and directing his remarks exclusively at Lord Walsingham, Germain said, "The king writes just as he always does, except that I observe he has omitted to mark the hour and the minute of his writing." George III always wrote the precise time to the last minute in his letters. Although Germain's remark was calculated to awaken interest around the table, the guests made no comment and repressed their curiosity, owing to the presence of his three daughters. The moment that his daughters left the room, Germain told the dinner party guests of his just having heard that the Comte de Maurepas, the first minister of France, was lying at the point of death. Wraxall replied that if he were the first minister of France, it would grieve him to die without knowing the outcome of the great contest between England and America. Germain responded that the French minister had survived long enough to witness the result. Wraxall thought Germain was alluding to an indecisive naval action off the Chesapeake Capes between the fleets of Britain and France. Wraxall then explained he had meant to say that it was a shame that the dying French minister would never know the final result of the war in Virginia. Germain repeated that the French minister had survived to witness it completely. "The army has surrendered, and you may peruse the particulars of the capitulation in that paper." Without any visible emotion, Germain removed the paper from his pocket and gave it to Wraxall, who read it aloud while the other guests sat in stunned silence. The news cast a gloom over the rest of the evening as the party pondered the political fallout. The guests really wanted to know how George III had reacted to the news. They were well aware that the king would find it especially painful, as it was the most humiliating event of his reign. George III had become the driving force behind the war and had threatened to abdicate rather than accept defeat. Germain gratified the wishes of his guests by reading aloud the letter from the king, while remarking that the letter was a testimony to the king's fortitude, firmness, and consistency of character. Wraxall recalled 30 years later that the lapse of time had not erased the deep impression that the reading of the letter had made on him that evening. It contained not a word of despondency or despair, while the handwriting indicated complete composure of mind. The king wrote defiantly that the news did not make the smallest change in his views, and that he was ready to continue the war. He would not admit defeat. 1. The British loss of America is a subject of perennial interest, not least because it gave birth to two powerful modern nations, the United States and Canada. It was a war Britain seemingly should have won. It had spent 8 years waging what the staunchest supporters regarded as a holy war against dangerous revolutionary principles, which threatened a general subversion of every system, religious or civil, hitherto respected by mankind. Even moderates believed the retention of America was essential to the survival of Britain as a great power within Europe. According to Adam Smith, the author of The Wealth of Nations, 1776, the expectation of a rupture with the colonies has struck the people of Great Britain with more terror than they have ever felt for a Spanish armada or a French invasion. Britain had the advantage of a professional army, the largest navy in the world, officers who were veterans of many campaigns, the availability of military supplies, and ready access to credit. Britain had a vibrant economy which was leading the way in agricultural innovation, commerce, banking, credit, and canal building, and was fast becoming the first industrial nation in history. It is little wonder that many contemporaries imagined that the war would be an easy triumph for Britain. When events turned out otherwise, it is equally understandable that the failure was attributed to poor leadership. The 10 biographical subjects of this book were the key British decision-makers who oversaw the conduct of the War for America. They include George III, who was portrayed in the Declaration of Independence as the tyrant responsible for the American Revolution. Lord North, the Prime Minister regarded as having triggered the war with his fateful decision to punish the people of Massachusetts for the Boston Tea Party through the coercive acts of 1774. General Sir William Howe and Admiral Lord Richard Howe, the brothers commanding the British Army and Navy in America during the first half of the war, who are regarded as having missed the best opportunity to defeat the Continental Army in 1776. John Burgoyne, the general who surrendered at Saratoga, 1777. Lord George Germain, the Secretary of State for America and the chief architect of the American War in Britain. Sir Henry Clinton, commander of the British Army in America during the second half of the war, when he was accused by critics of inactivity. Lord Cornwallis, whose surrender at Yorktown effectively ended the British War for America. Admiral Sir George Rodney, one of the few commanders to emerge with his reputation enhanced from the war, but who failed to prevent the French fleet of Admiral François-Joseph Paul, Comte de Grasse, from entrapping Lord Cornwallis's army at Yorktown. And John Montague, Earl of Sandwich, the first Lord of the Admiralty, whom critics held responsible for the inadequacy of the Royal Navy. These political and military leaders became the object of satire, emanating from critics who ranged from writers like Philip Freneau, Thomas Paine, Mercy Otis Warren, and Francis Hopkinson in America, to the poet Robert Burns in Scotland and the caricaturist James Gilray in England. They continue to be ridiculed in fiction, popular history, and movies. Although less crudely presented, such caricatures permeate even scholarly literature. It is glibly assumed that failure must have been a consequence of incompetent and mediocre leadership. The men who lost America were on the wrong side of history. They were associated with opposition to progress and with attempting to introduce an authoritarian style of government. They were the enemy in an event that has become part of an American national mythology, wherein Britain represented antiquated aristocratic attitudes that must inevitably fail against the meritocratic and republican virtues of America. It is like a story. The end of the war is a foregone conclusion as history progresses toward modernity. The men who lost America were able and substantial individuals who nevertheless failed. This book takes a warts-and-all approach that will consider their defects and their roles in contributing to the defeat, but it will also take issue with the popular misconception that they were simply incompetent and hidebound. The difference between success and failure is often a fine line. Horatio Gates, the American general who won the Battle of Saratoga, 1777, was himself defeated by Lord Cornwallis at the Battle of Camden, 1780, who in turn surrendered at Yorktown. Admiral de Grasse played a major role in the victory at Yorktown after winning a naval victory against Rear Admiral Thomas Graves at the Battle of the Chesapeake Capes, 1781, but de Grasse was defeated and captured at the Battle of the Sant by Admiral Rodney, 1782. This book is an account of capable men who fought a closely contested war, but whose critics and victorious opponents are treated as giants in their respective national histories, such as Edmund Burke, Charles James Fox and William Pitt in Britain, and Thomas Jefferson, George Washington, John Adams, and Benjamin Franklin in America. The British generals in America were not the stuff of parody, but had much in common with modern-day military career professionals in their dedication and commitment. A career in the military was a life service. Many of the commanders were born into families with strong military traditions and associations. They joined their regiments and ships when they were little more than children. George III and his cabinet ignored seniority to select the ablest generals in the army for command in America. The men they chose went to great lengths to improve their military skills and knowledge of warfare. They studied strategy and tactics by visiting the locations of battles, by reading the latest theories, and by training abroad. In a profession where experience counted, they were seasoned veterans who had served in junior commands in Europe and America. They had served under some of the most distinguished commanders of the age and improved their skills by leading military maneuvers during the large-scale summer exercises conducted annually by the Army. They demonstrated great personal courage in action. With long absences from their families and the possibility of losing their lives for their country, their military careers required great sacrifices. The military leaders were members of an oligarchy, but they competed within that oligarchy and were fiercely ambitious. Owing to the practice of primogeniture, in which the eldest son inherited most of a family's wealth, younger sons had to seek successful careers. It was possible to buy army commissions, but the practice was not permitted for senior appointments, and at least a third of the junior appointments were not purchased. After 1760, the purchase and promotion system was subject to greater regulation. The army was even quite cosmopolitan, with many continental European officers, such as the Swiss-born generals Frédéric Haldimand and Augustin Prévost, who both served in the British Army in America during the Revolutionary War. The Royal Navy was more open than the army to talent and social mobility and was regarded as the best in Europe. This was a period in which success in public service could earn a fortune equal to that of a successful merchant or businessman. The officers in both services had the added incentive that success would be rewarded by governorships and sinecures. There was also the luster of national acclaim and the almost obsessive cult of heroism. The high social status of the officers of the armed services made military service a desirable occupation. Moreover, the social structure of the British military was unchanged when it defeated Napoleon. The purchase of army commissions was not abolished until 1871, at the height of the British Empire. The perception of the British leadership as incompetent has disguised the extent to which the outcome of the war was in doubt until the very end. It diminishes the achievements of American generals like George Washington and Nathaniel Greene, who won against enormous odds and able opponents in a bitterly contested war. Their letters were full of despair for reasons that modern readers find difficult to understand, because we are conditioned to thinking that the successful outcome of the revolution was inevitable. The British were in reality sufficiently formidable to force George Washington to spend much of the war evading battle. They inflicted major defeats on Washington at the battles of Long Island, 1776, Manhattan, 1776, Brandywine, 1777, and Germantown, 1777. The British commanders were not totally beholden to conventional European tactics of a war of posts, in which the main aim was to preserve an army to avoid the casualties of battle and succeed by an emphasis on maneuver. Indeed, European warfare was not exclusively confined to such limited tactics. While many British officers had previously served in America during the French and Indian War, 1756 to 63.
The British Army had more experience of frontier warfare and suppressing rebellions than any contemporary army in Europe.
British commanders adjusted their tactics to be more flexible in unconventional warfare by adapting uniforms to better suit the environment, by using light infantry, and by breaking with strict linear formations. Departing from the tradition of the infantry acting in three parallel lines, the commanders adopted loose formations of two extended lines which were not required to fire in regular volleys. Far from being hidebound, they broke the European practice by placing greater reliance on mobility and the terror of bayonet charges. During the Revolutionary War, the British infantry often fired only a single general volley before rushing the enemy with their three-sided 15-inch bayonets fixed to the muzzles of their guns. The British generals additionally appreciated the psychological dimensions of the war and the importance of winning popular support. If we take seriously the capabilities of the British leadership, the achievements of the American commanders appear much greater. The political leaders in Britain were also more talented than is often appreciated. A British Prime Minister is admired in the United States today for facing an avalanche of hostile questions for an hour a week during Prime Minister's question time in Parliament. Lord North had to face such a challenge for an average of 3 days a week during the parliamentary sessions. The political system was never so corrupt that governments were able to assume support through patronage, and there was no equivalent of a disciplined political party to sustain them. The prime ministers of this period had to win the confidence of the House of Commons by being persuasive. Lord North was a particularly skilled public speaker, who successfully defended the government and sustained majorities in the House of Commons. He was equally gifted in supervising the public accounts as First Lord of the Treasury and Chancellor of the Exchequer. The Earl of Sandwich, as First Lord of the Admiralty, and Lord George Germain, as Secretary of State for America, were both able bureaucrats. They were surprisingly effective in tackling the logistical problem of amassing the largest number of troops ever sent such a distance. The majority of cabinet members had long experience of military affairs. They were not novices. 2. The mutual recriminations within the British leadership contributed to the image of a war lost by incompetence. Lord George Germain had acrimonious relations with the successive commanders-in-chief in America, Sir William Howe, Sir Henry Clinton, and Sir Guy Carleton. General Clinton quarrelled with Admiral Sir Peter Parker and Admiral Marriott Arbuthnot. The commanders fell out with their subordinates, Howe with Clinton, Clinton with Cornwallis, and Rodney with Rear Admiral Sir Samuel Hood. Before the advent of a more fully developed sense of nationalism in the 19th century, these quarrels were endemic in an era when the defense of private honor often triumphed over public service. However, such disputes were too pervasive to explain solely in terms of personalities. They were also present in other theaters of the war, including Jamaica, where differences between Governor John Dalling and Admiral Parker had much the same sclerotic effect that they had between Clinton and Arbuthnot in New York. Similarly, in Britain, differences between Admirals Viscount Augustus Keppel and Sir Hugh Palliser divided the Channel Fleet. The sheer multiplicity of these debilitating arguments suggests broader causes beyond merely the indulgence of personal piques. They rather reflected competition for limited resources and a weak command structure. Furthermore, they were mirrored by similar divisions among the American revolutionaries. The British commanders and politicians were discredited not least because their enemies triumphed and their opponents wrote the histories. This was equally true in Britain, where the view that America was lost by incompetent leadership began during the war and became the popular orthodoxy in the immediate aftermath. When, in 1792, one of the earliest British consuls to the United States met President George Washington, he reported home that Washington was a great man, but I cannot help thinking that the misconduct of our commanders has given him the principal part of that greatness. Until well into the 20th century, British historians portrayed George III and Lord North as enemies of progress who secretly conspired to introduce an unconstitutional despotic form of government in both Britain and America. This version of events was central to Whig history, which was the orthodoxy on both sides of the Atlantic. It was a view espoused by the British politician and historian Sir George Otto Trevelyan in his influential six-volume History of the American Revolution, 1899-1905. In his History of the English-Speaking Peoples, 1956-58, Sir Winston Churchill condemned the British conduct of the Revolutionary War as unequalled in the history of the country for the multitude of errors. Every maxim and principle of war was either violated or disregarded. Churchill described Lord North's government as composed of ministers of poor quality. Surprisingly, American rather than British authors have written the most sympathetic accounts of the British side of the Revolutionary War. This was particularly true of the imperial school of history, which flourished in the United States in the early 20th century and culminated in the work of Lawrence Henry Gibson. In the Anglophile wartime atmosphere of America in 1917, a film producer was even imprisoned for 3 years for his negative portrayal of the British in a movie about the American Revolution called The Spirit of 76, following a court case entitled United States versus the Spirit of 76. Because the Revolutionary War was a national disgrace, British historians tended to ignore the subject. The first full-length biography of Lord North did not appear until 1913. The only scholarly biography of Sir Henry Clinton was published in 1962. And the only full-length biography of Lord Cornwallis in 1971. The American Revolution has never loomed large in British history syllabi. The major scholarly biographies of the British commanders are written primarily by Americans. The British dimension of the war remains undeveloped in most histories of the American Revolution. In contrast to the rich historiography about the Confederacy during the American Civil War, there is no equivalent literature on the British during the Revolutionary War. This is a loss for our understanding of the American Revolution. The paucity of studies is particularly remarkable when we reflect that the revolutionaries were largely reacting to British policy initiatives in the preliminaries to the war and acting defensively against British offensives during it. The British perspective is essential for making the war intelligible. 3. The men who lost America were not opponents of liberty and representative government. Far from conspiring to establish tyranny in America, they regarded themselves as defending liberty and the rule of law, which they believed could be safeguarded only by upholding the supreme authority of Parliament. They described themselves as Whigs and subscribed to the principles of parliamentary government established by the constitutional arrangements of the Glorious Revolution of 1688. On the eve of the American Revolution, there were popular conspiracy theories on both sides of the Atlantic. Just as colonial radicals believed that the king and a government cabal were scheming to destroy liberty in America, the British government attributed the revolution to the machinations of a small minority of rebels who wanted to seize power and declare independence. The government regarded the revolutionaries as establishing tyranny with their suppression of all dissent and their use of coercion to enforce compliance. During the first year of the war, there was the anomaly that both sides claimed to be fighting to defend the British Constitution. Both the Howes as well as Cornwallis had actually opposed the policies that led to the American Revolution. The British politicians and commanders were not ignorant bigots. They were conversant with the Enlightenment emphasis on rational thought in an era that prided itself on being an age of enlightenment.
George III created an outstanding library which became the foundation of the British Museum. He made the most significant additions to the Royal Art Collection since Charles I and founded the Royal Academy of Arts. He had a deep interest in music, architecture, astronomy, science, and agriculture. Educated at Eton and Cambridge, the Earl of Sandwich was the first nobleman to participate in the public declamation of classical authors at Trinity College. He was an able linguist, classicist, and scholar of the Orient. A poet and musician, he was a patron of the theatre and the opera. He had a keen interest in history, astronomy, and numismatics. In the period of the American Revolution, he supported voyages of exploration, including Captain James Cook's voyage to Australia. His name is commemorated in the Sandwich Islands in the Pacific. John Burgoyne was a successful playwright who was a friend of the actor David Garrick and the artist Sir Joshua Reynolds. Lord North was Chancellor of Oxford University. He was described as having a lively mind, broad knowledge, and a versatile intellect by both the historian Edward Gibbon and the philosopher-politician Edmund Burke. He supported one of the earliest petitions against the slave trade and was the principal benefactor of Eleazar Wheelock's School for Indians, which became Dartmouth College. A graduate of Trinity College, Dublin, Lord George Germain was a friend and chief patron of the American-born scientist Benjamin Thompson and the playwright Richard Cumberland. Sir Henry Clinton was an accomplished violin player and a serious classicist. Like Lord North, he was a friend of Edward Gibbon. Admiral Rodney was a patron of Sir Gilbert Blane, who was to become a major influence on naval medicine and the modern science of epidemiology. The program of imperial reforms that ignited the American Revolution was itself the product of an emphasis on rational thinking that we associate with the 18th century Enlightenment. The careers of some of the men portrayed in this book were revived after the war. Cornwallis achieved the most spectacular recovery when he was appointed to the highest military and civil commands in Ireland and in India. Sir William Howe, John Burgoyne, Sir Henry Clinton, and Lord Cornwallis were all promoted to the rank of full general. Burgoyne became a successful playwright. Rodney was given a peerage and emerged from the war with a reputation that was actually enhanced. Admiral Howe became a national hero with his defence of the Channel during the French Revolutionary Wars. Sir Henry Clinton was appointed Governor of Gibraltar. Lord North briefly returned to power in coalition with his former opponent, the most outspoken critic of the British War for America, Charles James Fox. In the wake of the Napoleonic Wars, George III's image was transformed from that of a despot to that of a symbol of stability and a bulwark of patriotism as Farmer George and John Bull. His popularity grew as his mental faculties and his powers diminished. Burgoyne was buried among the national heroes at Westminster Abbey. Admiral Howe, Admiral Rodney, and Lord Cornwallis were all commemorated with monuments at St. Paul's Cathedral. 4. The biographical subjects of this book confronted obstacles of such magnitude as almost to preclude the chances of victory in America. Their greatest challenge was the popularity of the revolutionary movement and the difficulty of waging a war of counterinsurgency. Between 1774 and 1776, the revolutionaries successfully took over control of the apparatus of government, including the assemblies, councils, court system, and local authorities, as well as the press. They ousted imperial officials. They gained ascendancy in the militias, which proved crucial in enforcing compliance, punishing loyalists, attacking supply lines, and conducting unconventional warfare against the British. The transition was relatively smooth because they already had a large measure of experience in self-government, and they were able to adapt existing representative institutions. Although the revolution was a civil war as well as a rebellion, in which families and communities were divided, the loyalists were slow to emerge as a party and failed to gain the initiative. Following the withdrawal from Boston in March 1776, Britain was not only evicted from the colonies in rebellion, but threatened with an American invasion of Canada. The British leadership was thereafter confronted with the task of conquering and occupying America. When the British Army was most victorious in 1776 and again in 1780, their success only served to reinvigorate and rally the militias and the Continental Army. The British commanders understood that they needed to win popular support, but this objective was often in conflict with the use of force and the imperative to win battles. Sir Henry Clinton, the British Commander-in-Chief in America between 1778 and 1782, wrote of the need to gain the hearts and subdue the minds of America. However, the very presence of the British Army helped alienate opinion in America. The British necessarily resorted to the recruitment of German mercenaries to bolster the small size of their army. Often known as Hessians, the mercenaries were recruited from a variety of different German principalities, including Hesse-Hanau, Brunswick, Ansbach-Bayreuth, and Anhalt-Zerbst, and about two-thirds came from Hesse-Kassel, hence the name Hessians. Some 18,000 German mercenaries served in the war, during which they made up an average of a third of the total British troops in North America and 37% by 1781. The British similarly attempted to compensate for the size of their army by appealing to those on the margins of American society, including the slaves of rebel masters and Native Americans. But the policy helped alienate white Americans, whose support Britain needed to win the war. The stories of plunder and rapes committed by the army similarly caused a backlash against the British. The men who lost America had to contend with a political system in Britain that frustrated the formulation of clear strategic priorities. The king was the nominal head of government and the army, but the powers of the monarchy were circumscribed by the political settlement between the monarch and Parliament that followed the deposition of James II in 1688. The king could not dictate strategy and policy, but rather had to obtain the agreement of government ministers and majorities of both houses of Parliament. Although he appointed the Prime Minister, the king had to choose a candidate who had the support of the majority of the elected members of the House of Commons. The party system was still very weak, which meant that governments were often coalitions of various factions, diluting unity of purpose. The concept of collective cabinet responsibility, in which ministers united behind an agreed policy, had yet to fully evolve. The British leadership was additionally impeded by the absence of a central command system to provide essential coordination between the various departments of government responsible for the war effort. The army lacked an equivalent of a general staff and had no direct control over the transportation of troops. At the outset of the war, there were a dozen different departments that administered the army. The War Office was the only department specifically responsible for the army, but its role was confined to the administrative affairs of the regiments, and it was led by a civilian, the Secretary at War, who did not have cabinet rank. Until 1779, three different departments were responsible for transporting soldiers, ordnance, provisions, camp equipment, hospital stores, horses, and clothing. The different departments competed for the hiring of ships and paid different rates for freight. After 1779, the Navy Board undertook the business of transportation, which was an improvement but still involved an elaborate system by which orders for the Board had to be relayed through the Admiralty. When Lord George Germain became Secretary of State for the American Department in 1775, he was essentially the chief director in Britain of the war, but he had no direct control of the Navy, the Army transports, or the provisions. It was a fractured system of command. George Washington and the Continental Army faced similar administrative problems, but with the crucial difference that their government and army were not separated by a distance of 3,000 miles. The shortcomings of the administrative system were compounded by the logistical problems of fighting a war across the Atlantic Ocean. The voyage took at least 2 months and sometimes 3 to 4 months in either direction. The government initially assumed that the army would become relatively self-sufficient in feeding itself from territory repossessed in America. In reality, the army and navy continued to rely on provisions and supplies from Britain. The army was larger than most cities in America, with an average of 34,000 men and 4,000 horses, who daily consumed 37 tons of food and 38 tons of hay and oats. According to one estimate, in April 1778, the army required 127,400 pounds of candles to light 4,900 rooms. Accompanying the troops were women and children who were fed respectively on half rations and quarter rations. The proportion of women to soldiers doubled during the war. The government also had to feed and clothe a growing number of loyalist refugees, runaway slaves, prisoners of war, and Native Americans. There were insufficient warehouses and docking facilities in America. The supply ships were often detained and used as floating warehouses, making them unavailable for the return trip. The geographical expanse and the difficult terrain complicated logistics and diffused British forces in America. There were so many uncertainties and difficulties in providing transportation and supplies that precise timing and smooth implementation of military operations were virtually impossible. Owing to adverse winds and storms, supplies and troops frequently arrived late. The time spent assembling, loading, and unloading cargoes added further delays. The provision ships and army transports required naval convoys, which restricted the frequency and flexibility of their sailing dates. Although the amount of baggage carried by the army is often cited as an example of a hidebound European approach to warfare, the British Army had little choice but to carry its provisions and camp equipment on long campaigns while moving among a generally hostile population. It did not have much opportunity to improvise for supplying its needs without alienating the local population. The need for economy was a major restraint upon military operations. The government always had to consider the necessity of keeping down the cost of the war in order to maintain the support of domestic taxpayers. For much of the 18th century, there was a popular fear that the country might be unable to support the burden of the national debt. This was a major issue in British politics and was largely responsible for the fatal decision to tax America. Britain was among the most highly taxed nations in Europe. Between 1700 and 1783, the per capita rate of taxation doubled and the national debt rose 15-fold. Furthermore, the growth in the rate of taxation far outpaced the growth in the gross national product. The interest payments on the national debt accounted for about 43% of tax revenues in the decade before the American Revolution and rose from £2,735,925 to £9,406,406 between 1757 and 1783. The payments on interest and on the military accounted for between 75 and 85% of government expenditure. From 1778, the obstacles to British success in America escalated with the transformation of the American Revolutionary War into a global war against France, which expanded to include Spain in 1779 and the Dutch Republic in 1781. Britain was more isolated than at any other time in its history, even more than in 1940. Far from being what television documentaries invariably call the most powerful force in the world, the army was relatively small owing to the long-standing British distrust of it as a potential instrument of tyranny. British military successes consequently depended on alliances with other powers in Europe. During the successful 7 Years' War, 1756 to 63, the worldwide conflict in which the French and Indian War was the North American theater, Britain had been allied with Frederick the Great of Prussia. William Pitt the Elder later boasted that America had been conquered in Germany, because Prussian troops had played a crucial role in tying down French troops, enabling Britain to concentrate upon the conquest of Canada. After 1763, however, the old system of alliances broke down. Britain alienated Frederick the Great and broke the Prussian alliance by negotiating a separate peace with France, as well as being a victim of its own success because of the sheer scale of its victories, which became a source of hostility and distrust elsewhere in Europe. It stood aloof from the first partition of Poland in 1772 and the War of the Bavarian Succession between Austria and Prussia in 1778-79. In June 1773, negotiations collapsed for an alliance with Catherine the Great of Russia. By the time of the American Revolution, Frederick the Great was anxious to remain on peaceful terms with France, and the French foreign minister, the Comte de Vergennes, was equally determined to avoid war in Europe in order to focus resources upon Britain. It was in vain that Britain belatedly tried to negotiate a triple alliance with Russia and Austria in 1780. Even before France declared war in 1778, Britain's relations with Europe affected the war effort in America. To allay French concerns that the war in America was merely a prelude to a British attack on the French West Indies and to appease domestic taxpayers, Britain only partially mobilized its military forces in 1775. The budget for the Navy was actually cut so that the Navy was too small to support the army, to suppress privateers, to provide convoys, and to blockade America. Furthermore, the Navy was instructed not to intercept French ships carrying munitions and supplies to America in European waters, which precluded enforcing a meaningful blockade of America. From the beginning, France, Spain, and Holland supplied gunpowder, loans, and military equipment to America. The Marquis de Lafayette was only the most famous of Europeans who voluntarily risked their lives in the early days of the struggle for American independence. They included men who played a critical role in the victory against Britain, like Baron Friedrich Wilhelm Augustus von Steuben, Count Casimir Pulaski, and Thaddeus Kosciuszko. After 1778, the British Army and Navy were engaged not only in the war for America, but in the protection of the British possessions in the West Indies, the Mediterranean, Africa, and India. The army was spread throughout the globe with garrisons in outposts of empire from Antigua, Jamaica, the Bahama Islands, Minorca, Gibraltar, and Gorée in West Africa, to Bombay in India. After 1779, the army's North American garrisons included Pensacola and St. Augustine, Augusta, Charleston, New York, Newport, and Quebec. There were inland strongholds at Forts Niagara, Detroit, and Mackinac City in the upper Midwest, and at Kaskaskia in Illinois, Manchac on the lower Mississippi, and Mobile. Exclusive of Canada, they amounted to some 27 different garrisons to be supplied and supervised in America. The last battle of the American Revolutionary War was fought in India. Moreover, the defense of Britain became a primary objective with the threat of attack during the summers of 1778 through 1780. In 1779, the danger of invasion was greater than at any time since the Spanish Armada in 1588. There was simultaneous concern about the possibility of a revolution in Ireland. The American War of Independence was the only war in the 18th century in which Britain did not have naval supremacy and did not have a two-power navy that was able to match the combined fleets of France and Spain. After 1778, Britain was trying to win the war in America with fewer troops and a smaller navy than it had deployed in America in 1776. The biographical chapters of this book will evaluate their subjects in terms of the constraints and the obstacles that contributed to their failure. This multi-biographical approach will enable the listener to see the war from the perspective of several individuals rather than the partial views of one participant. The sections are arranged to emphasize both victory and defeat. It was partly because the war was never a linear series of defeats that the British government persevered in the belief that victory was possible in America. Part 1. The View from London. For if America should grow into a separate empire, it must, of course, cause a revolution in the political system of the world. Speech of Lord North, November the 20th, 1778. Chapter 1. The Tyrant, George the Third. The Declaration of Independence casts George the Third as the leading villain of the American Revolution. It asserts that he is a prince whose character is marked by every act which may define a tyrant, and pronounces him unfit to be the ruler of a free people. John Adams, who had been a member of the committee that drafted the Declaration, later admitted that it contains expressions which I would not have inserted if I had drawn it up, particularly that which called the king tyrant. Reminiscing at the age of 88, Adams thought it too personal, too passionate, and too much like scolding for so grave and solemn a document. He confessed that he never believed George to be a tyrant, or to be guilty of the cruel acts committed in his name. In his autobiography, Adams was also critical of Benjamin Franklin for his severe resentment and personal animosity toward George III. According to Adams, regardless of the appropriateness of the occasion, Franklin never missed an opportunity to cast aspersions upon George III. In one of the most incongruous and remarkable encounters between former adversaries, after the Revolution, John Adams and Thomas Jefferson actually met George III. The revolutionary leaders and the monarch whom they had vilified came face to face. As the first ambassador of the United States of America, Adams was presented to George III at St. James's Palace in June 1785. It was an emotional encounter between an outspoken advocate of independence and a king who had considered abdicating rather than accepting the loss of America. Dressed in a black formal coat with silk breeches and a sash, Adams told the king that the meeting would form an epoch in the history of England and America. He said that he thought himself more fortunate than his fellow citizens in having the honor to be the first to stand in the royal presence in a diplomatic role. He hoped to be instrumental in restoring the old good nature and humor between people who, though separated by an ocean and under different governments, had the same language and a similar religion. He stressed the cultural ties that bound them, not the recent politics that had separated them. According to Adams, George III seemed much affected and answered with a tremor in his voice. Assuming an air of familiarity, George III jested with John Adams that some people believed Adams was less attached than his fellow countrymen to France. Despite his surprise and embarrassment at what he thought an indiscreet comment, Adams attempted to match the royal humour, replying that he had no attachment but to his country. As quick as lightning, George III responded that an honest man will never have any other loyalty. After receiving a signal from the king to leave, Adams observed royal protocol by stepping backward and made his last bow at the door of the royal chamber. Accompanied back to his carriage by a royal official, Adams passed through the royal apartments, where at every stage the serried ranks of servants, gentlemen porters, and underporters roared out like thunder, "Mr. Adams's servants! Mr. Adams's carriage!" Adams was delighted that his person, his status, and his country had been accorded respect and kindness beyond his expectations from the king. Adams and his wife Abigail subsequently became quite fond of George III. In the summer of 1786, John Adams arranged to introduce Thomas Jefferson, who was to receive a less civil reception from George III. At the time, Jefferson was not known as the primary author of the Declaration of Independence, an association that he did not promote until the rage of party politics in the 1790s. Unlike Adams, he was known to favor France over Britain in his capacity as the U.S. ambassador in Paris. On the day of his presentation, there was an unusually thin attendance at court, consisting of a few members of the royal family, government ministers, and foreign ambassadors. Other than an entry in his account book of the tips that he paid the porters at St. James's Palace, Thomas Jefferson wrote nothing of the encounter at the time. Writing 35 years later, in his autobiography, Jefferson was more forthcoming, relating how it was impossible for anything to be more ungracious than the notice that George III gave Mr. Adams and myself. He saw at once that the ulcerations of mind in that quarter left nothing to be expected on the subject of my attendance. According to Adams's grandson, the king publicly insulted them both by turning his back upon Jefferson and Adams, which was not lost upon the circle of his subjects in attendance. Jefferson certainly never ceased to blame George III personally for the breakdown in relations leading to the revolution. Jefferson believed that from the beginning of his reign, George III had schemed to impose a tyranny on America, and wrote that future ages will scarce believe that the hardiness of one man adventured within the short compass of 12 years only to build a blatant and undisguised tyranny. After his return from London to Paris in August 1786, he wrote sardonically of George III as the American Messiah who had labored for 20 years to drive the nation to discover its own good, and who had not a friend on earth who would lament his loss so much and so long as I should. In Jefferson's mind, George III always would be the villain, the antagonist in America's primordial narrative, its myth of origin. For Jefferson, this was not propaganda, but objective truth. In reality, George III had less power than virtually any other monarch in Europe. During the 17th century, Britain had had two revolutions of its own, in which the supporters of Parliament successfully deposed Charles I and James II. After the execution of Charles I in 1649, Britain was a republic for 11 years, and following the fall of James II in 1688, Parliament negotiated a revolutionary settlement in what became known as the Glorious Revolution. It included a Bill of Rights, 1689, and a Toleration Act, 1689, which became the foundation of the British Constitution and ensured that the Crown would henceforth govern through Parliament. The monarchy retained the power to appoint the government, but its choice was limited in practice to prime ministers who had support in Parliament. Although the system of elections was corrupt and the Crown had considerable influence through patronage, the survival of the government was always dependent upon the support of independent members of the elected House of Commons. The British consequently regarded their political system as a bastion of freedom and liberty, in contrast to the absolute monarchies of Europe. 1. George III's accession seemed like the dawn of a new age with unbounded promise. It coincided with the dramatic expansion of the British Empire in America, the Caribbean, and India. In a worldwide conflict, 1756 to 63, known as the 7 Years' War in Europe and the French and Indian War in America, Britain won a series of spectacular victories against France. There was much self-congratulation about victories won in every quarter of the globe. William Pitt boasted that the British had overrun more of the world than the Roman Empire. In 1760, amidst great anticipation and euphoria, George III was crowned king. He was the first native English speaker to sit on the throne since Queen Anne, 1702-14. At the beginning of his reign, he proclaimed that he was born and educated in the country, and that he gloried in the name of Britain. He was a youth of 22 who was variously described as tall, robust, graceful, affable, cheerful, fair, and fresh, with blue eyes, auburn hair, and a strong, melodious voice. He was very conscious of having a tendency to corpulence, which he kept in check by plenty of exercise and horse riding. Horace Walpole, whose memoirs did so much to denigrate the reputation of the king among later historians, was initially favourably impressed. He described how the king did not stand in one spot with his eyes fixed on the ground, in contrast to his 77-year-old grandfather and predecessor, George II. He walked about and spoke to everyone. In September 1761, the popular frenzy mounted when the new king chose to marry a 17-year-old German princess, Charlotte of Mecklenburg-Strelitz. George III seemed to embody the culture, breadth, and inquisitiveness that we associate with the Age of Enlightenment. He was fluent in French and German and familiar with Italian. His interest in science surpassed that of any of his predecessors. He assembled the finest contemporary collection of scientific instruments within the first decade of his reign. He was particularly fond of astronomy and built the Royal Observatory at Richmond to view the transit of Venus in 1769. He was the patron of William Herschel, who transformed the understanding of the solar system and the universe by his discovery of the planet Uranus in the year of the Battle of Yorktown, 1781. George III was fascinated by mechanical devices, especially clocks and watches, which he was able to dismantle and reassemble. He commissioned a table to chart the principles of mechanics and an air pump to demonstrate the properties of the atmosphere. He was keenly interested in gardening and horticulture, expanding the royal gardens at Kew and appointing Sir Joseph Banks as his botanist in 1771. He was similarly interested in agriculture and farming, which later earned him the nickname of Farmer George. He was an accomplished horseman who liked to go out riding every day, and he enjoyed regular visits to the theatre. George III also became the most significant royal patron and collector of art since Charles I. In 1768, he was influential in the founding of the Royal Academy of Arts and remained closely involved in its administration, helping it relocate to Somerset House in 1780. George III was especially enthusiastic about the work of the Pennsylvania-born artist Benjamin West, who was a founding member and second president of the Royal Academy. Trained by Sir William Chambers, George III was himself a competent architectural draftsman who did many of his own plans and drawings. He was a patron of many of the leading architects of his era, including James Athenian Stuart, Robert Adam, James Wyatt, and Thomas Sandby, and commissioned the landscape architect Capability Brown. He loved music. He played the flute, pianoforte, and harpsichord, collected compositions, including the works of Lully, Palestrina, and Scarlatti, and during his courtship of Queen Charlotte, he composed a song for her called The Royal Bride. He several times invited the 8-year-old Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart to perform for the royal family during his visit to England in 1764. Before his departure in 1765, Mozart dedicated a set of sonatas for harpsichord and violin to Queen Charlotte. George III later tried to persuade Joseph Haydn to stay permanently in London and was instrumental in the revival of his favourite composer, George Frederick Handel. He was an enthusiastic bibliophile whose collection became the foundation of the British Library and numbered 65,000 books by the time of his death in 1820. George III was conversant with the works of contemporary literary writers, philosophers, and historians like Edmund Burke, Edward Gibbon, Samuel Johnson, and James Boswell. He permitted scholars to use his library at the Queen's House, which later became Buckingham Palace. Samuel Johnson described him as the finest gentleman I have seen, and thought him the first monarch in 100 years to identify seriously with the interests of his people and to try to make friends with his fellow countrymen. In 1767, when the king heard that Johnson regularly visited the library at the Queen's House, he asked the librarian to introduce them and then proceeded to quiz Johnson about his views on current theological debates, his thoughts on the best literary journals, and whether there was any important work being done at Oxford University. When the King asked him about the progress of his own writing, and Johnson replied that he thought he had already done his part as a writer, the King replied, "I should have thought so, if you had not written so well," which delighted Johnson as a compliment fit for a king to pay. It was decisive. After the meeting, Johnson famously told a friend that he did not reply, since it was not for me to bandy civilities with my sovereign. George III is wrongly alleged to have said to Edward Gibbon, "Another damned thick square book? Always scribble, 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 eh, Mr. Gibbon?" It was actually said by his brother, the Duke of Gloucester. 2. George III did not instigate the colonial policies that triggered the American Revolution. The government ministers, not the king, were the architects of those policies whose origins predated his reign. When he ascended the throne, George III was politically inexperienced. Throughout the 1760s, he was preoccupied with the problem of forming a stable government. The king appointed the ministers of the government, the most significant of the political powers remaining to the monarchy, but his choices were confined to men who were able to command majority support in Parliament and were governed by domestic rather than imperial considerations. George III not only did not initiate the policies that led to the breakdown in imperial relations, but he was even a restraining influence on some of the more extreme measures proposed by his ministers. His first statement about affairs in America recommended that the colonies receive proper compensation for their expenses in the French and Indian War. He discouraged George Grenville's government from including a clause in the Quartering Act, 1765, that permitted the billeting of soldiers in private houses in America. He later remarked that the Stamp Act was abundant in absurdities, having first deprived the Americans, by restraining their trade, from the means of acquiring wealth, and then taxed them. He supported the conciliatory colonial policies advocated by the Duke of Grafton's ministry in 1769. George III advised against the more draconian proposals of Lord Hillsborough, the Secretary of State for America. He agreed that the abolition of elections for the Council of Massachusetts Bay might indeed, from a continuance of their conduct, become necessary, but till then ought to be avoided, as altering charters is at all times an odious measure. He similarly advised against the proposal to abolish assemblies that denied the absolute sovereignty of Parliament. He argued that such action was of so strong a nature that it rather seems calculated to increase the unhappy feuds that subsist than to assuage them. He cautioned that colonial governors ought to be instructed to avoid as much as possible giving occasion to the assemblies again coming on the apple of discord. He suggested that a hint be given that colonies that submitted to the Townshend duties, 1767, might be exempted from the tax on tea. He had been willing to grant such a favour to Virginia and the British West Indies in 1769, but desisted because the Virginians were so offensive the last spring. It was not until the Boston Tea Party, 1773, that George III suddenly became actively involved in the growing imperial crisis in America. He became more vehement from the conviction that the crisis had been caused by too much lenience towards the colonies. He regretted that Britain had previously indulged them by repealing the Stamp Act in 1766. Believing that any concessions were likely to be interpreted as a sign of weakness and that they would only encourage further demands, he was against appeasement of the colonies. He was much impressed by the advice of the commander of the British Army in America, General Thomas Gage, that "they will be lions whilst we are lambs, but if we take the resolute part, they will undoubtedly prove very meek." He denied wishing to use force, but argued that it was the only means of success. George III saw the struggle as fundamental to the defence of order and the Constitution. A devoutly religious man, he treated political issues in moralistic terms. Later in his reign, he opposed legislation to give Catholics the vote in Ireland because he believed it his duty under his coronation oath to uphold the Anglican Church. In America, he argued that he was fighting the battle of the legislature in defense of the authority of Parliament to govern America. It was essential to the maintenance of order and hierarchy that the colonies acknowledge the supreme authority of Parliament. As the revolutionary movement became more republican, he became ever more passionate about crushing the rebellion and defending the dignity of kingship. He regarded monarchy as essential to liberty, as part of a system of checks and balances in which the crown acted as a constitutional safeguard against the excesses of both the aristocratic and the democratic elements of the government in the House of Lords and the House of Commons. George III strongly endorsed the coercive acts which became the catalyst for the American Revolution. Based on the concept of collective responsibility and passed by Parliament at staggered intervals in the spring of 1774, the coercive acts were a series of laws that aimed to punish Massachusetts for the Boston Tea Party. George III wrote that he was unable to refrain from expressing his pleasure when he heard that the first of the acts, the Boston Port Bill, had been passed a second time without either a debate or a division in the House of Commons. When Thomas Hutchinson, the American-born governor of Massachusetts, arrived in England, George III immediately had a two-hour meeting with him and favorably impressed Hutchinson with his knowledge of America. Hutchinson wrote a word-for-word account of his conversation with the king that included descriptions of his facial expressions and body movements. George III asked Hutchinson detailed questions, including whether John Adams was related to Sam Adams. He was already familiar with Sam, but wanted to know more about John. However, his questions had a random quality and lacked focus. As has been said of his architectural interests, he concentrated on detail at the expense of understanding broader themes. The king afterwards claimed that Hutchinson had assured him that he thought the Boston Port Bill was a wise measure and that he was consequently persuaded that the measure would successfully subjugate Boston. This was not the recollection of Hutchinson, who was much opposed to the bill, and who wrote after the meeting that he had told the king that it was extremely alarming to the people of Boston. George III was pleasantly surprised by the absence of opposition in Parliament to the coercive acts. It confirmed in his mind the rectitude of the policy. He was glad to find that the debate had ended earlier than was expected, and that the government majority was so considerable for the Regulation of the Government of Massachusetts Act, which was arguably the most unpopular of the acts. He was delighted with the results of the 1774 general election, which increased the government majority in the House of Commons, causing him to comment that the election had returned more landed gentlemen as opposed to East India nabobs and West India planters, whom he thought not ready for the battle with America. Months before the outbreak of actual fighting in September 1774, he had concluded that the die was cast and the colonies had to either submit or triumph. In November, he was convinced that the New England governments were in a state of rebellion, in which blows must decide whether they are to be subject to this country or independent. In November 1774, when General Thomas Gage began to have reservations about the use of force in America and urged caution and the suspension of the coercive acts, George III thought this the most absurd suggestion possible. He again repeated that there was no choice except to master the colonies or leave them to themselves and treat them as aliens. Prime Minister Lord North also began to shrink from the prospect of war and proposed sending out peace commissioners to the colonies to investigate the dispute. The king was opposed on the grounds that such overtures would be unlikely to make the colonies reasonable and would give the impression that the mother country was afraid. He permitted but disliked the less ambitious plan put forward by North, known as the Conciliatory Proposal, 1775. In 1775, George III's views over America began to differ sharply from those of the opposition speakers in Parliament. Edmund Burke and William Pitt the Elder made some of their best orations in favour of conciliation, and the Rockingham opposition group recoiled from a military solution when push came to shove. Although conspicuously passive in 1774, the merchant lobbies began to equivocate. There was a sudden profusion of petitions in favour of conciliation and peace, the first modern example of a popular anti-war protest movement, which was signed by the equivalent of one-tenth of the electorate. At the instigation of Lord Mayor John Wilkes in April 1775, the Livery of London, representing the trade associations, and the popularly elected Common Hall of the City of London petitioned the King in favour of America. The King became adamant that only the use of force was likely to succeed. In February 1775, he vowed never to look right or left, but to pursue steadily the track that his conscience dictated. He was convinced that the colonies would submit if confronted with greater vigour. In March, he reflected that the more he considered the best approach to the crisis, the more he became convinced that a combination of rectitude, candour, and firmness must, with time, be crowned with success. After the outbreak of the war in April, he had no doubt that the British nation had lost patience with the conduct of America. He thought any action short of compelling obedience would be ruinous and culpable, and vowed that no consideration would make him swerve from the present path. He was confident that he was doing his duty and must never retreat. He became impatient with debates on America and thought the House of Commons could not possibly tolerate hearing the same speeches so frequently repeated. He insisted that we must with vigour pursue the means of bringing the deluded Americans to a sense of their duty. George III, therefore, ignored colonial requests for him to serve as a mediator and readily embraced a policy of coercion. In April 1775, he broke with tradition by refusing to receive the address from the Livery of London sympathetic to America, which had obliquely compared him to the deposed Stuart King James II. He henceforth made it a policy not to receive addresses from the Radical Livery and Common Hall. He particularly despised the Common Hall for its association with his nemesis, the populist politician and Lord Mayor John Wilkes, who had presented the address supporting America. He regarded the petition as fresh insolence from the shop that has fabricated so many. Admitting that there were 1,000 reasons to wish not to receive insolent addresses, Lord North tried to persuade the King against slighting the Common Hall. He warned that a change of protocol might be productive of more evils, while nothing was lost by following the traditional procedure of receiving and rejecting such addresses. Since it would only revive Wilkes's popularity if he were seen to be so studiously avoided by George III, North advised the King to alter his method of dealing with him. The King remained obdurate and unwilling to hear myself insulted by receiving an address instigated by Wilkes while sitting on the throne. In August 1775, George III was impatient with the progress of the ministry in issuing a proclamation of rebellion in America. He thought it necessary for the government to show determination in prosecuting with vigour every measure that may tend to force those deluded people to submission. Lord North then issued a proclamation in the King's name for suppressing rebellion and sedition, which accused the colonies of having proceeded to open and avowed rebellion, and declared anyone abetting their cause to be traitors. It was necessitated by the outbreak of war and the need to cut off military supplies to the revolutionaries in Boston. However, it dashed the hopes of loyalists and moderates in the Continental Congress like John Dickinson, who still sought to compromise with Britain. by refusing to receive John Dickinson's Olive Branch petition, which promised to support royal authority in the colonies, George III disappointed those colonists who sought his mediation. Richard Penn, a staunch loyalist and former governor of Pennsylvania, carried the petition to London, but the king avoided receiving it until after the government had issued the proclamation of rebellion and sedition. When he finally did acknowledge the petition, he refused to hear it while seated on the throne and made it clear that no answer would be given. He had good constitutional reasons for his action, since the petition essentially invited him to act against Parliament. Nevertheless, George III's contempt rankled even the Loyalist members in the Assembly of Pennsylvania. In a speech before Parliament in October 1775, the King dismissed such conciliatory gestures as meant only to amuse by vague expressions of attachment to the parent state and the strongest protestations of loyalty to me, whilst they are preparing for a general revolt. His speech, which called for a speedy end to the military preparations in the colonies and for foreign assistance in suppressing the rebellion, had a great impact on colonial opinion. It was no longer tenable for colonial revolutionaries to continue to declare loyalty to the king. Throughout the summer of 1775, in his capacity as Captain General of the Army and Prince Elector of Hanover, George III began to negotiate for foreign mercenaries from Germany. Writing personally to Catherine the Great, he additionally tried to obtain Russian troops. Although he was merely carrying out a decision of his cabinet, he had committed a double offence in the eyes of the colonists, in abdicating the basic responsibility of government to provide protection, and in using foreign troops against his own subjects in America. In November 1775, he opened Parliament with a speech against the daring spirit of resistance and disobedience to the law in Massachusetts. The event was witnessed by Thomas Hutchinson, who told a correspondent that it was much stronger in the manner of its delivery than when read in print. In Massachusetts, Abigail Adams predicted that the speech would stain with everlasting infamy the reign of George III. 3. The part played by the king gave the colonies the impression that it was he who had rejected them rather than the other way round. Until it became apparent that he was actively committed to a policy of coercion in 1774, George III was not a target of personal attack in America. Indeed, he was treated with more deference in America than in Britain, where periodicals like the North Briton and the Public Advertiser, which published the anonymous Letters of Junius, were comparable to the worst examples of modern tabloid journalism, replete with libelous innuendos, such as the suggestion that the king's mother was having an affair with the Earl of Bute. The most devastating charge in the British press was that parliamentary government had become a mockery and a mere screen for a cabal of unelected advisers, the so-called king's friends, who used corruption and bribery to manipulate Parliament. On the other hand, until 1774, Americans concentrated their criticism upon government ministers and Parliament. John Witherspoon, the president of the College of New Jersey, observed that the king was the object of far greater insults in his own metropolis than ever were thought of or would have been permitted by the mob in any part of America. Indeed, Americans continued to recognize the authority of the king, for the crux of the imperial crisis was the colonial denial of the supreme authority of the British Parliament. By 1774, colonists like James Wilson and Alexander Hamilton were writing pamphlets that denied this authority in America. At the same time, Americans continued to acknowledge the king as the sole source of imperial authority and sought his intervention against Parliament. In late 1774, they were still making declarations of loyalty to George III, even while they prepared to send representatives to the First Continental Congress. In New London, Connecticut, a royal salute was fired as the names of the local representatives were announced. In New York, a band played God Save the King for the departure of Representative Isaac Lowe. The Continental Congress petitioned the king as the loving father of your whole people and toasted his health. Even after the outbreak of war in April 1775, the colonists indulged in the fiction that they were fighting in the name of the king against a wicked ministry and defending British liberties against Parliament. Until well into 1775, they even referred to the royal troops as the Ministerial Army or the Parliament Troops. The royal arms remained on public buildings. Criminal cases were tried in court in the name of the king. The Anglican clergy prayed for the king to overcome his enemies, and most provincial assemblies continued to date their laws by the year of the king's reign, while formal documents ended with, "God save the king." In A Summary View of the Rights of British America, the 31-year-old Thomas Jefferson penned the hitherto most audacious colonial pamphlet to admonish George III. Published anonymously in Williamsburg, Virginia in 1774, Jefferson asserted that kings were the servants, not the proprietors, of the people. Despite the insubordinate tone, Jefferson called upon the king to be a mediator and even to resume the exercise of the royal veto, which had fallen into desuetude since 1707, when Queen Anne became the last British monarch to veto an act of Parliament. Jefferson wrote that it behooved the king to think and to act for himself and his people, thereby inviting the king to exceed his traditional authority and act independently of Parliament. It was an opportunistic argument that reflected the desperation of the colonists to find a constitutional formula to enable them to circumvent the claims of the absolute authority of Parliament while remaining subjects of George III. They were reluctant revolutionaries. Jefferson's anonymous pamphlet was reprinted in the London Chronicle, where he was described as a respectable merchant of Cumberland County in Maryland. With the escalation of the war, the fiction of opposing Parliament and not the king could not last. During the summer of 1775, John Cleveland, a pastor in Ipswich, Massachusetts, writing under the pseudonym of Johannes in Eremo, argued that the adage that the king could do no wrong was nonsense. He reminded his readers of the compact in which the people swore an oath of obedience to the king in return for his protecting their rights and privileges. Following the skirmishes at Lexington and Concord, April the 19th, 1775, Cleveland bid King George III adieu. "No more shall we cry to you for protection. No more shall we bleed in defense of your person." In London, on October the 23rd, 1775, an American by the name of Stephen Sayer, a former Lord Mayor who had returned as a merchant to his native city, was accused of a plot to kidnap George III en route to the state opening of Parliament. Allegedly, he planned to imprison the king in the Tower of London and force him into exile in his German dominions in Hanover. The allegation was made by Frank Richardson from Pennsylvania, a lieutenant in the 1st Regiment of Foot Guards, who claimed that he had heard the details from Sayer. Published anonymously in January 1776, Thomas Paine's Common Sense ended all discretion about implicating George III. Paine did not list personal grievances against the king, but instead sought to undermine the mystique of the crown and to challenge the institution of monarchy. He mocked the contradictions in the system of monarchy, in which kings were shut away from the world, yet their business required them to be all-knowing. It was not a divine institution, but an artificial contrivance. It had a dubious ancestry, with forebears like William the Conqueror, who was nothing more than a French bastard landing with an armed banditti and establishing himself as King of England. Although Paine did not mention the name of George III, he still fired some well-aimed barbs at the royal brute of Britain and the hardened, sullen-tempered pharaoh the wretch that with the pretended title of father of his people can unfeelingly hear their slaughter and composedly sleep with their blood upon his soul. Paine famously declared that one honest man was worth more to society than all the crowned ruffians that ever lived. In the summer of 1776, the destruction of royal images, the removal of the royal arms, and the removal of the royal name represented America's symbolic break with George III. In Massachusetts, juries refused to serve because the writs are in the king's name, and the assembly passed a bill for disusing the king's name in all acts, commissions, and law processes. Following the Declaration of Independence in July, the royal arms on public buildings, coffee houses, and tavern signs were ripped, trampled, and burned, often in front of crowds shouting repeated huzzas. John Adams described how it was the fashion in Philadelphia to reverse portraits of the king and hang them upside down. There were mock trials, executions, and funerals of George III. At Bowling Green, at the southern end of modern Broadway in Manhattan, a crowd pulled down the gilded lead equestrian statue of George III, sculpted by Joseph Wilton, that depicted him in Roman garb in the style of the statue of Marcus Aurelius on the Roman Capitol. The head was severed from the body, which together with the horse was taken to Litchfield, Connecticut, where local women melted the lead into bullets. The tail, a few fragments, and the marble base of the pedestal survive in the collection of the New York Historical Society. The colonial opposition embraced conspiracy theories, claiming that the king had destroyed the traditional balance of government by gaining total control over Parliament to establish a tyranny in Britain and America. In July 1776, the Declaration of Independence exaggerated the role of George III with its long litany of grievances against him personally. It aimed to show that he had imposed unremitting injuries and usurpations that had, as a direct object, the establishment of an absolute tyranny. It blamed him for decisions of royal governors in which he had had no role and episodes that predated his reign. Jefferson's original draft of the Declaration even listed the slave trade among the litany of grievances against George III. However, he also included a condemnation of the British people that was removed by the Continental Congress for fear that it might alienate potential support in Britain. The Declaration's personal charges against the king were critical for justifying rebellion by showing that it was directed against a state of tyranny. Having for years believed in the blessings of the British Constitution, the colonists found it easier to conceive of the tyranny of an individual than the collective tyranny of Parliament. Especially in the emotionally charged atmosphere of 1776, the Declaration of Independence made for good propaganda to stir up hatred against an individual rather than a collective abstraction. As the last acknowledged source of imperial authority in America, George III was inevitably the final scapegoat. 4. If contemporaries exaggerated his role in the origins of the dispute, George III was nevertheless crucially influential in prolonging the war, which became a personal crusade. He saw the conflict in apocalyptic terms as the most serious contest in which any country had ever engaged. George III articulated more cogently than any of his ministers the justification for the war and the vital stakes for Britain, but his emphasis shifted over time. He initially defended the war in terms of supporting parliamentary authority and the Constitution, but he increasingly argued that the war was essential to the survival of Britain as a great power in Europe. He regarded the empire as a crucial source of national wealth and power that would inevitably collapse if Britain lost America, since the other colonies would soon follow and seek independence. The British Caribbean islands would be the first to cast off obedience, not in a spirit of rebellion, but rather because they were dependent on the mainland colonies for food and supplies, and Ireland would be next domino to fall. As Britain faced a combined armada of the forces of France and Spain in the summer of 1779, George III preferred to risk an invasion rather than lose the Sugar Islands in the Caribbean, without which it would be impossible to raise money to continue the war. There was no choice, the king thought, but to persist with the war or to face ruin. The loss of imperial trade and the consequent decline of manufacturing would reduce Britain to the status of a poverty-stricken island. He hoped never to live to see that day that Britain would so far lose its sense of self-esteem as to be willing to grant independence to America and consequently to fall low among the states of Europe. 4 months before the British surrender at Yorktown, October the 19th, 1781, he remained convinced that there was but one line to follow. "For we are contending for our whole consequence, whether we are to rank among the great powers of Europe or to be reduced to one of the least considerable." Indeed, anyone who thought otherwise did not deserve to be a member of the community. As late as November 1781, he again wrote that the die was cast, and that Britain would be either a great empire or the least dignified state in Europe. In his capacity as Captain General of the British Army, George III was necessarily engaged in the planning and execution of military strategy. He collected books about warfare and regularly attended the summer encampments of the army around London. He reviewed the Guards' regiments two or three times every week, copied naval charts, and collected models of major fortifications. The topographical collection in his library included records of military campaigns, fortifications, barracks, and canals. He knew the strengths of the fortified towns of the continent and the soundings of the chief harbours in Europe. Under the guidance of the Earl of Sandwich, First Lord of the Admiralty in North's government, he became better informed on naval matters than any of his predecessors since James II. George III avidly followed every detail and initialed every page of every official document concerning the war for America placed on his desk. He read rebel newspapers, complaining on one occasion that they smelled of the pies in which they had been smuggled into New York. He did not have the final say in strategic matters and was several times overruled by the cabinet, but he was nonetheless influential in the direction and conduct of the war. In a memorandum of 1777, he modified General John Burgoyne's plan of the conduct of war from Canada, criticizing him for underrating the German mercenaries and eliminating Burgoyne's option of sailing by sea from Canada to join Sir William Howe. Although he made fewer appointments than his grandfather George II, Lord North complained that the king exerted too much influence over military promotions and assignments. George III especially favoured Lord Geoffrey Amherst, a hero of the French and Indian War, whom he twice tried to persuade to become Commander-in-Chief in America in 1775 and 1778. Despite constant solicitations from the king for advice, Amherst was unwilling to commit himself in cabinet meetings, where he was known as a man of few words. George III selected and personally appointed generals William Howe, Henry Clinton, and John Burgoyne. He was instrumental in persuading the Earl of Sandwich to appoint Admiral Richard, Earl Howe, to the command of the Navy in America. However, he made such appointments in consultation with the cabinet and military advisers. Together with Lord George Germain, the Secretary of State for America, he favoured the high-risk strategies of generals like Burgoyne and Charles, Earl Cornwallis, rather than the caution of Sir William Howe and Sir Henry Clinton. He argued that some risk was necessary, or otherwise we shall only vegetate in this war. He preferred to get through it with spirit, or with a crash be ruined. Owing to the void in leadership created by the doubts and hesitations of his Prime Minister, Lord North, George III was more than simply committed to the cause, but became the chief driving force in the war for America. Lord North was a man of considerable ability, but was unsuited to the task of a war leader. He was the first to acknowledge his shortcomings in his self-deprecating correspondence. He tellingly preferred not to think of himself as Prime Minister, but rather as just another member of the Cabinet who represented the Treasury. Furthermore, North lacked conviction in the cause and was increasingly despondent. He continued to hold out for a negotiated peace. At the beginning of 1778, without consulting the Cabinet, North prepared a peace plan whose terms included a complete renunciation of colonial taxation and the sending of a peace commission to America. The King was opposed and advised him not to sue for peace, since whatever he proposed was likely to be unacceptable to the Americans and to dissatisfy Parliament. Following news of the failure of North's peace commission, led by the Earl of Carlisle in August 1778, the King wrote that any further concessions would be a joke. In understanding that nothing short of the recognition of independence would satisfy the American Congress, George III was in many ways more realistic than Lord North. George III flattered and cajoled his Prime Minister to rouse him to action and keep him at the helm. He praised his financial management and his leadership of the Treasury. At the beginning of the war, his letters showed affection and respect, describing North as his sheet anchor, whose ease and comfort he wanted to secure in every transaction. The King was grateful to North for replacing the Duke of Grafton, who had suddenly resigned as Prime Minister in 1770. He appreciated North's skills as a parliamentary manager, who was also able and honest in the conduct of public affairs. When North defended the record of the government following the British defeat at Saratoga in 1777, the King was delighted by North's firm and dignified role in persuading the Commons to see the present misfortune in true light as very serious but not without remedy. He promised that he would never forget the friendship and zeal shown by Lord North and reminded him of the support he had from the Cabinet, how sincerely he was loved and admired by the House of Commons, and how he was universally esteemed by the public, which reflections must rouse your mind and enable you to withstand situations still more embarrassing than the present. He told him that he was too diffident of his own abilities and was delighted when North spoke to him in a very frank manner, as if unbosoming to a friend. When flattery did not succeed, George III exhorted, goaded, and bullied Lord North. He was worried by the absence of planning and the disunity of the Cabinet. In January 1778, he urged North to deliberate without further loss of time upon the future mode of conducting the war for America. He added that it was even more important that the government had a plan to repel the attacks of opposition parties with their tactic of calling for papers and demanding inquiries. This, he wrote, must be digested by you. He encouraged his Prime Minister to discuss such matters in the next Cabinet meeting and to have minutes taken in order to achieve some consensus and to unite the Cabinet when facing the questions of the opposition. He told him that he needed to explain government policy in advance to the most influential members and the independent country gentry in the House of Commons, who might otherwise oppose the government, because they were either not informed or did not understand the subject. These were valid, implied criticisms of North's modus operandi. With the imminence of a French declaration of war at the beginning of 1778, North attempted to resign and requested that the King open negotiations with members of the opposition. He had long felt inadequate to his task and overwhelmed by the responsibilities of his position. He became particularly anxious over his inability to negotiate a peace that was satisfactory both to the patriots and to the present zealous friends of government. He believed his continuance in office to be an obstacle to any chance of a negotiated peace with America, and feared that whatever he did must inevitably cause him misery and disgrace. Pleading that his health and understanding were greatly impaired by struggling so long in an office to which he was unequal, North asked the King to choose a successor less tainted by past policies. In March 1778, He asked to be relieved immediately, since the longer he remained in office, the worse the consequences. He asked that his continuance in the government should not be made a necessary condition of negotiations to appoint a successor. The present situation required new men and able men. North wrote that he regarded capital punishment as preferable to the constant anguish of mind that he felt while he continued to be Prime Minister. North complained that the King had constantly refused to grant him permission to resign, with the result that the issues had become more difficult, leaving him even more unequal to his role as Prime Minister. He wrote that he could not conceive what induced the King to be so determined to keep him, despite so much evidence of his unfitness for his position. He believed that the King saw the state of the country in a better light than it deserved when public and private credit was so low. He doubted whether the country could continue to obtain loans to finance the war for 2 more years, reminding the King that the power of borrowing had been hitherto the principal source of greatness and weight of Great Britain. He thought the King should be glad if an accommodation with America prevented a war with France. North feared that Britain would suffer more than her enemies from the continuance of the war, not by defeats, but by an enormous expense, which will ruin her and will not in any degree be repaid by the most brilliant victories. He warned that the consequent economic hardships would be attributed to the obstinate perseverance in the American war. George III was impatient with North's always recurring to the need for a total change of government. The King made it clear that he would never voluntarily consent to his resignation, which he would treat as a personal act of betrayal. In March 1778, he sent a remarkable letter to North in which he demanded to know whether he did indeed intend to desert him at the hour of danger. He wrote that he was becoming more exasperated with North constantly suggesting measures that he had repeatedly told him he would never submit to, as I look upon it as disgraceful to me and destruction to my kingdom and family. He complained that he was tired of North never ceasing to talk about his resignation and peace negotiations with America. He regarded North's avowed despondency as highly detrimental to the service of government, and felt obliged to ask him whether he intended to remain in power, a query to which he expected explicit answers in writing. He implored North to cooperate with him and exert himself in putting vigor and activity into every department of government. North replied by repeating his request to quit, but he fatally agreed to serve the rest of the parliamentary session in expectation that the King would soon appoint a successor as Prime Minister. North begged, "Let me not go to the grave with the guilt of having been the ruin of his, King and country." George III alternated between appealing to North's loyalty and chiding him. He implored him to remember that his resignation would be detrimental to the Crown and the public, whose interests were inseparable. He gave North several pep talks in which he warned him that the greatest part of his difficulties arose from his proceeding too far with plans, especially appointments to offices, without consulting him. George III asked where else might North find a greater confidant to repose his undigested thoughts more safely than in the breast of one who had ever treated him more as his friend than minister. In November 1778, the King became positively hostile. He demanded that North complete a plan forthwith for dealing with the opposition in the next Parliament. A week later, he berated him for his dilatoriness and failure to do what he had asked. When North responded that he was conscious and certain that he had neither the authority nor abilities requisite for his position, it occasioned an outburst from the King, who demanded an explanation in writing of what he meant by not having the authority. George III had become so distrustful of his wobbling Prime Minister that he began to monitor him through 2 members of North's inner circle, Charles Jenkinson, the Secretary at War, and John Robinson, the Secretary to the Treasury. North was incensed when he discovered a letter from the king to Robinson criticizing him. In a series of sycophantic and ingratiating letters, Jenkinson commiserated with the king on his disagreeable situation in having to deal with North. Aware that North knew nothing of this, Jenkinson was nervous about being seen too often at court in case it alerted North's suspicions. He reassured the king that the Prime Minister would not resign if his resolve was stiffened. His weak mind needed only the king's support and firmness to help him recover his spirit. He encouraged the king to discount North's protestations and threats of resignation because he really intended to remain in government as long as possible. On another occasion, he suggested that North's declarations were merely pretexts to shift the blame and responsibility for the war to the king, concluding that the meaning of all this is that he may have it to say to the world that he is ready to retire, but that Your Majesty insists on his continuing in his present situation. According to Jenkinson, Robinson thought him a prophet for predicting that North would never voluntarily give up power. Far from vacillating, North was undeviating in his requests to resign. In June 1779, Jenkinson wrote to the king, saying that North was in good spirits and determined to go on, but North wrote to the king that he hoped that he would not think it unbecoming of him to renew his request to resign at the end of the session. North reminded the king that he had tried to resign every year since he had taken office, for which he blamed himself, but he was now convinced that his presence was among the principal causes of the perilous state of the country. His attitude was unchanged later in the year when he wrote that he was contented to retire without an honour or sinecure, since he was really so broken and did not feel able to trust his own judgment. North claimed that he had been miserable for 10 years in obedience to the king and was unable to endure the combination of misery and guilt, especially when nobody approved his conduct. North's desire to resign remained unchanged throughout the last 2 years of his premiership. In November 1779, he wrote to the king that it was absolutely necessary that he should be permitted to retire and be replaced following the end of the parliamentary session. Much to the chagrin of George III and Jenkinson, in April 1780, North was so distraught that he spoke of his desire to retire in favour of his leading parliamentary opponent, Charles James Fox. George III had no alternative but to retain Lord North if he wanted a Prime Minister who was both willing to continue the war and able to command the support of the House of Commons. Horace Walpole understood the King's situation, namely that he had nobody to put in his place. The King admitted as much, telling Lord George Germain, "Although he is not entirely to my mind, and there are many things about him I wish were changed, I don't know any who would do so well." George III equated opposition to the war with treason, and was therefore not inclined to negotiate with the opposition parties. He ridiculed those who supposed the Americans to be poor, mild persons who, after unheard of and repeated grievances, had no choice but slavery or the sword. He talked of "that perfidious man and trumpet of sedition," who was the leading opponent of the government, William Pitt the Elder, Earl of Chatham. North had wanted to be replaced by Chatham, who, although fiercely opposed to the war, was adamant that Britain should not grant independence to America. North wrote bluntly that the king's only objection was his fear of the domineering Chatham assuming too much authority. In April 1778, during a speech on America in the House of Lords, Chatham dramatically collapsed and soon afterward died, removing the most viable alternative candidate to replace North as Prime Minister. George III was appalled when the House of Commons voted Chatham a state funeral and a monument in Westminster Abbey, finding the compliment "rather an offensive measure to me personally." Rather than allow the opposition leaders into government, George III was willing to risk a constitutional crisis. This was clear from a series of letters he wrote to North during March of 1778. The king solemnly declared that nothing would bring him to deal personally with Lord Chatham. He wrote that it was not private pique, but an opinion formed on an experience of a reign of now 17 years that makes me resolve to run any personal risk rather than submit to opposition. The king was insistent that he would not be made a slave by the opposition for the remainder of his days. He preferred to risk his crown than do what he regarded as personally disgraceful by withdrawing from America. He thought it impossible that the nation shall not stand by me. If they will not, they shall have another king, for I will never put my hand to what would make me miserable to the last hour of my life. In reference to the two opposition leaders, the Marquis of Rockingham and the Earl of Chatham, the king wrote that, rather than be shackled by those desperate men, he would rather see any form of government introduced into this island and lose my crown than wear it as a disgrace. Upon Chatham's death, the only alternative to North was opposition leaders who were committed to ending the war and therefore unacceptable to George III. After the French entered the war in 1778, the Rockingham party wanted an immediate end to the war and became reconciled to granting American independence. The Earl of Shelburne, who replaced Chatham as an opposition leader, was more ambivalent about this than Rockingham. He wanted an immediate end to the war, but hoped that it might be possible to continue an informal imperial relationship with America. His policy was to leave the revolutionaries to themselves, hoping that they would soon send commissioners to offer terms. Since the king found none of these aims acceptable, he had to keep North in power. Toward the end of his life, North defended himself by saying, "Year after year I entreated to be allowed to resign, but I was not allowed, and was earnestly entreated to remain." He remained on board until the bitter end, but who was driving the war? George III declaimed, "If others will not be active, I must drive." By dint of his forceful personality and his pertinacity in the closing months of 1779, the king kept the discordant elements of the government together. He bolstered his ministers against an opposition containing the talents of some of the most brilliant parliamentary orators, including Edmund Burke, Charles James Fox, and the Earl of Shelburne. He rallied his ministers to face a growing international threat. In June 1779, Britain faced the most serious danger of an invasion since the Spanish Armada from the combined fleets of France and Spain. In the Caribbean, Grenada and St. Vincent fell to the French. Ireland seemed to be going the way of America, with tens of thousands of people arming themselves in the volunteer movement, which was purportedly for self-defense, but soon began to lobby for greater autonomy. There was a virtual stalemate in the war in America. The government majorities were dwindling in the House of Commons, where Sir William Meredith made a motion for peace, declaring that no nation had ever sent fleets and armies of such strength and magnitude on so remote a service as those which Great Britain has poured into America. Lord North asked again to be allowed to resign at the end of the parliamentary session. George III was undaunted. He was ready both to ride the occasional defeat in Parliament and to call the bluff of ministers who threatened to resign. He wrote to North that he had frequently heard him say that the advantages to be gained by this contest could never repay the expense, which he likened to the attitude of a tradesman with his weighing scale behind his counter. George III conceded that no sane individual would now argue the laying of a tax was deserving of all the evils that have arisen from it. But step by step the demands of America had risen. Independence was their object, to which this country can never submit. There was no price too high to pay. On June the 21st, 1779, George III summoned the cabinet to his personal library at the Queen's House, the first time a monarch had done so since the reign of Queen Anne. At the meeting, he refused to give any intimation of the reason for the meeting. He broke normal protocol by inviting the cabinet to sit down around the library table with himself at the head. Lord George Germain told one of his under-secretaries that he began to think that they were going to be dismissed, and very probably they all thought the same thing. At this remarkable occasion, George III rehearsed the history of the colonial struggle, expressing regret only for changing his ministry in 1765 and consenting to the repeal of the Stamp Act in 1766. He praised the Earl of Sandwich for building up the navy and the treasury for the very abundant manner in which the war in America had been supplied. He defended the generals in America, Howe, Burgoyne, and Clinton, of whom originally everyone approved. He said that it was his principle and it was his resolution to part with his life rather than suffer his dominions to be dismembered, for he held it to be his duty to God and his people to preserve them entire at whatever hazard or inconvenience to himself. He therefore expected firmness and support from his ministers. He was willing to make new appointments to the cabinet if they desired, but in all events he expected they would support him. He spoke for nearly an hour, not by way of speech or formal harangue, but as a plain narrative delivered in conversation. He subsequently wrote to Lord North that, "I hope, after having so fully stated my sentiments this day, everyone felt how I am interested in the present moment, and consequently will feel that they can alone hope for my support by showing zeal, assiduity, and activity." As he later told North, he wanted to infuse the ministers with his spirit, but waited in the hope of finding them more resolved until the declaration of war with Spain. North continued on the brink of resignation, but the king had kept the show on the road. Writing in the 1940s, the historian Sir Herbert Butterfield found George III's robust and unflagging determination to fight to the last to be almost Churchillian. The king's letters resounded with rallying refrains, calling for firmness, resolution, boldness, zeal, alacrity, and vigor. He regarded firmness as the characteristic of a true Englishman. He vowed to march on whilst any 10 men in the kingdom will stand by me. He admitted that the times are certainly hazardous, but that ought to rouse the spirit of every Englishman to support me. He would never surrender.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.